Well, welcome, viewers and listeners online, and those of you who are with us here at the Boston University School of Theology for our program today from the Mary Baker Eddy Library on the subject of the education of a Christian Science military chaplain. I'm Jonathan Eder, Programs Manager at the Mary Baker Eddy Library, and I'll be moderating today's discussion. It's really very appropriate that we're broadcasting here from the BU School of Theology for this program. Military ministry has been an important part of Christian Science outreach to the world for a long time, going back as far as World War I. But it was in the 1950s, after the Korean War, that a step was taken to make military ministry for Christian Scientists a more professional program. So seminary education was deemed as critical as part of the formation to be a Christian Science military chaplain. And the BU School of Theology became the first site, the first institution to begin training Christian Scientists to enter military chaplaincy. I had the opportunity to talk to an individual who's written quite an extraordinary book on the history of Christian Science military ministry, Kim Chouette, and he provided me with some statistics on how many Christian Scientists have participated in the life of the BU School of Theology in preparation to go into military chaplaincy. So his statistics have 51 trainees between the years of 1956 and 2004, having successfully gone through the program here at the BU School of Theology and become Christian Science military chaplains. Then since that time, there have been five others who've gone into active duty as Christian Science military chaplains. There are two who are awaiting assignment for active duty. And there are several who are currently here at the BU School of Theology training and studying to become military chaplains. So Christian Scientists have been a very vital part of the community here at the BU School of Theology. So we're very grateful to the School of Theology for hosting the program, and we're just delighted to be here. So we have representatives of those statistics that I just cited to you here as part of our panel. Two of them here on my left to the far right are currently studying here at the BU School of Theology. They are Brian Bort and Sarah Sanfis. Hello, Brian and Sarah.
Hello.
It's great to have you with us. They're both in their third year of the Master of Divinity program in the chaplaincy track. And Brian, as I understand it, just completed this past January the first phase of his military training. So he's gotten dusted up a little bit, and he's gotten a taste for that side of it. Sarah's a little bit further along, as I understand, in her her training. And this past summer, she was involved in an internship that's a part of the chaplaincy preparation at Langley Air Force Base. And part of that gave her some insight into some of the tasks that she'll be performing once she does become a military chaplain. She organized a luncheon for women warriors, she did a little preaching.
That's right.
So she's ready to go. Air Force, here she comes. And and also we have two graduates of the program here at the Boston University School of Theology. And they are to my right. Furthest to my right is Matthew Schmidt, and Matthew is chaplain captain in the military in the United States Army, and he is stationed with a reserve unit in Newport, Rhode Island, the Civil Affairs and Psychological Operations Command. You graduated from here in 2012.
Yes.
And interestingly, he also served the United States government in a different capacity back in 2003 to 2005 when you were in the Peace Corps in Malawi, Africa. So it's an interesting background to also bring to your work here. Also with us is Janet Horton. And Janet graduated from here in 1976, and if Janet doesn't mind, I'm going to read from her citation here from the Boston University School of Theology when she was distinguished as a distinguished alumna of the school. And this is what the Boston University School of Theology had to say about Janet. It reads, "Janet Horton has, with remarkable quality, embodied the essence of the mission of the School of Theology within the boundaries of the United States military. Colonel Horton is the Christian Science Military Chaplain Endorser. Serving as a pioneer in her role as the first woman to serve as a Corps Chaplain in the United States Army Chaplain Corps, Ms. Horton served for more than 28 years. Her persistence and dedication to principled Christian and selfless love and ministry had a broad and powerful impact on the U.S. military." So thank you for letting me read that. If I had asked her in advance, she wouldn't have let me do that. Finally, we're so pleased to be able to have the Dean of the School of Theology with us, Mary Elizabeth Moore. And she began here as Dean in 2009, and she broke what sometimes is referred to as the stained glass ceiling as becoming the first woman to be Dean here of the School of Theology. So for us at the Mary Bakerty Library, that's something that we cherish because of the various ceilings that our namesake broke through in her career. And I'm also going to read something about Mary Elizabeth. On her website for the Boston University School of Theology, she says that her passion is to journey with others to cultivate deeper faith, compassionate humanity in a more just, peaceful, and sustainable world. So welcome, Mary Elizabeth. And we'll be interested to hear how that passion works with the chaplaincy program here at the BU School of Theology. So I thought just to give us a sense of the how and why of military chaplaincy in general, and how it functions as part of our government and part of our armed forces, that I'd just play a little clip from a program that we had at the Mary Bakerty Library back in 2012, where Janet answers a question on this point.
I was born in Ireland, and I've spent over half my life here in the United States. And by the way, I'm a Methodist from Ireland, so we're not very many. But I am absolutely fascinated by the fact that the government is paying you to offer full-blooded, no-holds-barred Christian religious services in the Army. And so my question has to do is, how does that fit with the more general sort of political theology in which, at least in America, you're supposed to have the separation of church and state? It seems like this is just a massive exception to what, in fact, is the... I just speak as an ignorant outsider at this stage. The massive exception to what one hears about the core of what America's about, namely the separation of church and state.
I had to write, when I was with Department of Defense level in the Pentagon, I had to write what was called a religious support primer to sort of explain the chaplaincy because nobody understands it. The undersecretaries didn't get it, and unless you've actually, you know, been in contact with the chaplaincy, the other branches don't even understand it. And one of the things I said in there is it's probably one of the most amazing miracles that you'll ever see because you have all these people of different denominations. I mean, we're just as comfortable with each other as anything. But the second point that I helped them to understand is the government can make anybody a cook, or they can teach them to be a mechanic, or they can go to a law school and say, give me an attorney, or they can even go to a medical school and say, give us a doc. But the one thing they cannot do is make somebody a clergy person. And so they have to go to the churches and say, we can't do that. Because of that separation of church and state, the government can't make somebody a clergy person. They can't train them. The only people who can ordain or endorse, or depending on whether it's a lay tradition or an ordained is only the churches. And so in essence, they're just lending their clergy to the military. If at any point that church determines they're being asked to do something they don't want them to do, or the person is uncomfortable with what they're doing or whatever, at any moment, it doesn't matter where they are in their career, the church can pull them right back and they're theirs. And so it's a very, it's being lent to the military. And again, they pay their wages because they're providing that religious support to soldiers, sailors, airmen, or Marines.
Yeah, so Matt, what's it been like? What drew you into exploring this as a call and as an occupation? And Janet was talking to the how and why of the chaplaincy. What is the how and why for Matthew Schmidt as a military chaplain?
Sure. So first, I'd just like to say it's great to be back at Boston University, and it's nice to be here without having any homework due. So I started right out of high school. I went into the military. I served 3 years, and I thought I was done. And I went into college, graduated college, worked about 8 years in the field, and then I went on to Peace Corps, where I served in Malawi, Africa. And I'm looking back, I see how the military kind of worked back into my life. And I was defending military soldiers' rights to be in the Peace Corps. There was some people were voicing the idea that a soldier shouldn't be in the Peace Corps because any number of reasons. And so I had written a letter saying that the motives are there and the skills and everything they learn. And so that was kind of the start of it. I got back and I was active in the peace movements. I'd go to rallies and things. And then I found that I was praying about peace. I was also finding that a lot of my prayers were engaged with the military, both as kind of the manuals and techniques and ways of engaging would kind of humanize. I'd celebrate that. And then the challenges facing the soldiers, I was drawn to pray about it. And then I moved to Washington, D.C., and my church was very close to the Walter Reed Hospital. And that's where a lot of our soldiers were coming back after they had injuries. And so there was a lot in the news at the time about how those soldiers weren't receiving the care that most people deemed was necessary. And so I tried to reach out through my church and offer care, whatever seemed appropriate. And then I was working in a Christian Science reading room in Washington, D.C., and one of those soldiers came in. And it just, there was a really beautiful connection with kind of these spiritual resources and the need that he had. And so I started becoming more aware of the way that I could serve in that ministry. And then I actually happened to read an article by Janet. And she was talking about the engagement that she had and some of the ways she served. And it just seemed like a natural fit. And I knew that that's how I was going to go into the chaplaincy. So I enrolled, I moved to Boston. And then now I serve as a battalion chaplain, as you said, down in Newport.
So tell us a little bit about what that means, being a chaplain, battalion chaplain in Newport. And what kind of picture does it give you of the religious diversity of people in the armed services?
So I think it's one of the main reasons the battalion chaplains exist is to provide for the free exercise of religion. And so anybody in my battalion that has a religious belief that they want to exercise, I'm there to support. So as a Protestant chaplain, I perform religious services to those who are interested. So I may give a sermon, lead a worship service, have communion, anything along those lines. And then if somebody is outside of that, then I make sure whatever their religious practices are honored. So it may be a dietary restriction. It could be anything along those lines. And in my battalion, I have about 50% Catholic, a couple of Jewish folks. There's some that are studying Norse mythology. So part of my role was to better understand that. So I actually got a book on Norse mythology and tried to read and understand what that looks like. And so I think part of the role of a battalion chaplain is also advising. So the commander wants to understand how is the morale, the morals, the ethics of his unit. And then also is if we go on an operation, so we go downrange to Horn of Africa or something like that, the commander wants to understand how religion in that region is going to impact that operation. And so what religion and how that'll impact we're bringing, and then in the local area. So that's kind of a brief overview of what a chaplain does.
And your background and your practice as a Christian Scientist, how do you bring that to providing that kind of service to this broad array of different beliefs?
I think probably at the heart of what I've found, both being here at Boston University Seminary, the training with our endorsing agent, is that there's a desire on people's parts that hungers towards God. And so I try, as I've seen the grace in both here and our program, is to see that I'm there to respond as they are reaching out to God's grace.
Wonderful. So Mary Elizabeth Dean Moore, for thinking about Matthew and his path, how has the chaplaincy track developed here at the Boston University School of Theology? And what has been sort of your experience of the Christian Science contribution just to the school as a whole?
It's a good question. I'd like to start with the second one because okay. Matt just told his story so beautifully. Okay. We can't underestimate the influence of those 55 students mm-hmm. who graduated and been deployed. Mm-hmm. And then several other students who've either not graduated or have graduated and not been deployed. The presence of Christian Science students here in the School of Theology is felt. The way Matt tells his story is a window into the influence of Christian Science students here. You notice as he shares his story, he talks about suffering, the suffering in the hospital and other places, his response to suffering. He speaks about prayer, the yearning for peace, the importance of ethical response to the world in which we live, and that includes ethical response of the military. I cannot think of one single Christian Science student who's been here who doesn't bring similar emphases. They're all different. They're not. They don't come out of a cookie cutter mold, but they bring that kind of deep passion to respond to suffering with healing, to tend the world, and to tend the world toward peace, tend the world toward ethical action, and especially recognize the deep religious practice that underlies all of that. And for Christian Scientists, that religious practice is Christian and is specifically Christian Science. But the kind of respect that Matt just expressed for the religious practices of people of other faith traditions also marks our Christian Science students. So that's a huge influence here. And if I could just add one little twist to that, since Janet Horton is sitting here. Janet has occasionally been here to speak with our students, and the commendation on the plaque is nothing compared to her stories.
I know.
I know you know that. But Janet Horton's life story, every aspect of it is inspiring. And so this we see frequently in our Christian Science students and in the elders of the Christian Science community, the not elderly elders like Janet, a kind of embodiment of Christian faith that's inspiring. So that is the second part of your question. The first part of your question, I'll try to be shorter, but our program emerged partly because of the Christian Science influence, because we recognized that the close relationships we had made us all the more aware of our own mission in relationship to chaplaincy. And we began to have conversations in the community, informally at first, and sometimes in the form of conferences. So the first movement for us was conversation, and it was informal, but we've continued that. So as we've built the program, we've increasingly built the conversations. Informal conversations among students, conferences, visitors who come and speak with us and engage with us in conversation and so forth. So that's a very important part of our program, is that conversational element. Then we began to develop the course element. So we began to develop specific courses in chaplaincy, military chaplaincy, also hospital and other forms of chaplaincy. And that includes preparation for being with people one-on-one, preparation for leading services in very mixed communities and so forth. That led us another step, which was to develop a curriculum. So now we have a track in our Master of Divinity program that is in chaplaincy, and we're finding that students really yearn for that. We've just had prospective students on campus last week, and many of them are interested in the chaplaincy program. This is where they feel pulled, because so many young people, as well as older people, are so aware of the suffering in the world, and they want to respond to it, and they want to be in the places where people suffer, and be in the places where people seek healing, be in the places where people are seeking healing, not just for individuals, but for the larger society. And then I'll add one other piece. So we have conversation, courses, curriculum. Another C is collaboration. We have begun working with other theological schools in order to reflect on what kind of preparation do we need to be doing for military chaplaincy. We have actually learned a great deal from the Christian Science students and graduates from this school. And we have a conference coming up in April, which Shelley Rambo is leading. She's the leader of the chaplaincy track. She is the leader of this conference, and she's actually the leader of our collaborations, not only with other other schools of theology, but also with the various branches of the military.
Well, you mentioned Shelley, and for some of you who maybe saw the advertisement for our event, Shelley was originally going to be here. So thank you very much, Mary Elizabeth, for filling in for Shelley. Shelley had some pressing family matters that she had to attend to. So, but we're very grateful to Shelley because she was very instrumental in getting this event arranged here at the BU School of Theology. So we look forward to connecting with her in the future.
And I'm a poor stand-in. However, just watch for her. Watch for your opportunity to go here and speak with Shelley, because she's terrific.
Well, great. Well, these two individuals are part of your current brood, and just very anxious to know what first of all, brought you into the study for to become Christian Science military chaplains, but also what have you found to be most meaningful so far in your experience here at the BU School of Theology?
For me, one of the most important things for my study is that I've always loved the Bible ever since I was a really little girl. But as a lay tradition, you know, we don't train pastors formally, and so I didn't realize that you could study the Bible and could go to school for that. And so I'm so excited to be in theology school and to be studying it more in depth, and it is really inspirational. For the military chaplaincy specifically, I got done with Christian Science class instruction, and once I'd had that, it was 2012, I started feeling the call to chaplaincy. And for a long time, I just thought, oh, no, that's not for me, and I'm not going to go in the military, you know, and just that sort of thing. But it kept coming. It kept coming up. And when something comes up repeatedly, it's a pattern, and it's time to pay attention. And so I did. I called Janet and spoke with her for a while. And at the end of the conversation, I said, well, if I wanted to do this, what would I do? What would be the first step? And she said, well, this was the interview, and you did great. Good job. and so we went from there. And it's hard to think of what is the most inspirational, but in studying the Bible and in my classes with other students from different denominations, it's amazing how inspirational they are and how talking with others about what does the Trinity mean? Or this week, it's Holy Week, what does that mean? What does it mean to follow Jesus? It's amazing how those conversations, they bring up for me, oh, what does Mrs. Eddy say about this? What does, you know, Matthew or John say about this? And then I go look at that. And then I start thinking, what does it mean for me? Yeah, and so being in this setting with so many different people from different traditions is just amazingly inspirational.
Brian?
Well, I can only ditto a good portion of what Sarah has said. My experience coming here is I was a track coach for about 7 years before coming here. And after some very significant, some challenges that required a lot of spiritual growth and work, and through that period of about 2.5 years, at one point very early, I received what I thought was a very specific call to ministry, and I, through the ebb and flow of challenge and grief, I forgot about it. And then about 2 years later, after a period of, you know, more than a year of just very solid daily study, feeling very much on my game, the idea came again. And at that moment, then I remembered the earlier one, and it, you know, a little tap on the hand, like, okay, sorry, I forgot, but that's an idea that requires action. And so I started getting in touch with folks, with my teacher, my Christian Science teacher, and then with Janet Horton in Boston. And I was living in California at the time, really liked where I was, liked the communities that I was a part of, and fully expected to go to school in the Holy Hills near UC Berkeley. And I was on the phone with Janet about a minute and a half. She was describing the program here in Boston and at Boston University. And I was sold. I just thought, absolutely. Where else would I go? And so I think the most significant part of that discernment process was as I came to Boston for an interview with Janet and with Russ Gerber at the time. And there were all kinds of applications, all kinds of forms I had to fill out, and they basically took those and put them aside, and through a variety of questions, essentially asked, what's the quality of your heart? How much can you love? And I almost broke into tears right there in the interview just because I realized that's the question. That's the question I wanted to be asked, and that's what I wanted to work on. And I'm not saying by any stretch that, you know, my scores on those categories were, you know, were sufficient to the task, but it was something that I could apply my whole effort to with no reservations. And so that, you know, shortly into that interview process, I was just sold, just invested 100%. And then what reinforced that was going through all the five different applications to BU, Department of Defense, Mother Church, the Albert Baker Fund, the different organizations that all come together to help make it happen. That went by so fast that I was able to start in January, whereas I expected I was applying for the fall. And so I came and have never regretted coming. Have absolutely loved the journey here.
So have you found that your capacity to love has grown here in the corridors of the BU School of Theology?
I found my capacity to do more reading than I've ever done. The really critical thing about Boston University and the School of Theology in particular is that there is a language in engaging with other denominations that you really can't know unless you actually sit in that environment and engage with those groups. And Boston University is a spectacular place to do that. There are many different denominations, but there's a great deal of openness. And, you know, it's written in the concrete over Marsh Chapel that it will be an experimental expression of faith and practice. And so there is that that opportunity to learn the language of faith of other denominations, but also to learn how it is that you're going to communicate your faith with others. And that experience is priceless.
And it's very interesting for us to hear at the Murray Baker Eddy Library. What we do at the library is really care for the history of Mary Baker Eddy, as well as the really the history of all the institutions she founded, including the Christian Science Church. And for Mary Baker Eddy, that whole question of language was so central, and she worked hard at it throughout her life, and we see that in the numerous revisions of her chief work, Science and Health, that she made. So that language of the spirit that she was always perfecting is such an important part. And to to discover that that's such an important part of the community life and the interchange that goes on here, I think makes me think that it's just very natural that this should have been a progression for Christian Zionists to come here and be part of the educational environment and opportunity here. So Janet, not going to let you off the hook. So you're an endorser, and that's an interesting word. Sounds like an advertising company. What does that mean to be an endorser of people going into the military chaplaincy, and how does that compare with the other term that is used for some other religious groups of being an ordainer or somebody who provides ordination for somebody going into the chaplaincy?
Well, it's interesting that you played the clip because the military is so different than any other form of ministry. And so someone has to say, this person truly is a Catholic priest. He didn't just make that up. Or this woman truly has graduated from Boston University School of Theology, and the person in the church that she's going to represent in the military has said she has fulfilled the requirements from that church to be a person who would would either give services or whatever that church wants them to do. It might be a baptismal rite, it might be do weddings, whatever that is. So there has to be somebody that, in essence, produces what's called the bona fides for someone. And those people then go to the Department of Defense and say, we would like to lend our clergy to the military. And then you must fulfill their requirements. One of those requirements, of course, was education. And where our church as a lay tradition didn't require that, we had the opportunity to come to the Methodist seminary here, and there were people from different backgrounds, so it was a beautiful foundation for us to go into the military chaplaincy, because you had the opportunity to talk with folks from some other traditions and even a few folks from other faith groups. I just thought the education here was fantastic. To have the opportunity to sit with someone, one of my instructors, we literally would talk about how you felt like you saw the Old Testament lived out in front of you when Dr. Beck taught Old Testament, and it just came alive, and the sacredness of the text. You felt it from him. I just was so excited to find another idealist, and I could sit with Dr. Rauner and talk about what Tillich meant by something. And so in every way it prepared you, because it was very similar to... You have to explain what you mean to people in the military, because as we said in the little clip over here, almost no one understands the military chaplaincy. It is so different than anything else. And so most people would think of a chaplain as being in a chapel, and I'd say 80% of the time they're not. They're with their service members. If that service member is doing a 15-mile road march, you're out there doing that 15-mile road march. And where many people would never come to your office and say, Chaplain, you know, my heart's just sore over the loss of my uncle or whatever the problem was for the individual. If you're walking alongside of them on a road march and you sit down to have water, they'll sit down and they'll say, you know, there's something I wanted to talk about. And I've often said, they wouldn't care if you were a kangaroo. If you were the person who went through everything they went through in 107 degrees, you walked that 15 miles with them, or you went to Germany, or you went down to Bosnia, or you go wherever they go, because there isn't going to be, if you're in Germany, they can't even go to a Lutheran church because they're going to be speaking German. And so you're in essence there to provide for their religious needs. And you've got to be selfless to be in the military chaplaincy, because it's not just about what you think the ministry should be. It's where is that person and what is the need that they have right now? And do you love them enough? And the thing you're going to do is, you know, they've got a sacred text. And like I say, one thing that you really felt when Dr. Beck talked about it or when you were here is the sacredness of people's text to them and how that speaks to any situation that a person could possibly be in. And so rather than sitting down and talking sophisticated theology, we would sit down and talk about, you know, there's a Bible story that's very similar to what you're going through. And look how Daniel did that when he was put in a lion's den. Do you feel like you've been thrown in a lion's den or whatever it was, or in a fiery furnace like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? So it's just beautiful to have that opportunity wherever you are to sit down with that person and maybe take them right back to that sacred text that means so much to them, and how it can feed them, and how that word of God is just perfect for the situation that they're wrestling with.
So how many years have you been an endorser?
Oh gosh, 15, oh no, we're 16 now. 10 years, yeah, 10 years. It just goes by so quickly.
And so what has been your learning experience? What has been your education as an endorser?
Oh boy. Well, I think it's way harder than being in the chaplaincy. It's a very joyous thing to work with folks like Matt and Sarah and Brian. To get people who truly love the Bible, who love the ministry, and have them get together and discuss things that they're studying here at BU, to talk about how would you do that when you're over in, let's say, Bosnia, or you might be in Iraq. And it's interesting because these things are, again, this is so different, most people don't have a concept of it, but wherever we go, it seems like one of the big issues is safety. And so one of the things I felt I learned so much here at BU was that there's a unity for people when you can find that thing that is the unifying concern. And so like when we went to Germany, we had to take reservists who were flying in from the States, and they had to drive in icy, snowy conditions in Autobahns at 100 miles an hour, people driving around that had no clue what they were doing. We were flying helicopters in less than ideal weather or whatever, and we had a German division with us, and everybody, all of the leadership was just terrified about the safety of our soldiers. And yet the thing that united us, I got together every chaplain, the Germans sent over their priest, we had lay leaders that you could name a tradition. We had people laying on the floor praying, and for 2 hours I invited them to share what would be from their sacred text assurances that God loved his people and would take care of them and that they could trust him. And for 2 hours, everybody was so moved by what we did. And so we agreed that every day during that 8-week exercise with 8,000 people out there, that we would pray for the safe, specifically pray. And we would go to these texts. Over 8 weeks, the first thing that happened was the German general got up in a video teleconference, passed out, and they medevaced him. And they said, there's no way he's going to come back. They figured it was appendicitis or something like that, and they were going to have to operate on him. We put out the word. Everybody from all those different traditions prayed specifically for him. Within a day and a half, he was back, and he said at the next video teleconference, they said, the doctors have no explanation for why I'm back. And the doc would get up every day, and he'd have to say how many problems there had been, you know, as a doc. And he would get up and say, well, I'm basically out of business. He said, I haven't even given out a cold packet, you know. And it was interesting because the very last part of the exercise was you had to simulate jumping a 200-person operations center. And jumping means you move the location of it. And so in order to do that, they took a room about this, or a tent about this size, and put 200 people in it. And you literally measured how many inches elbow to elbow each person had to maintain their function. And the people had been so struck by how the chaplains had made a difference that they said, the chaplain won't fit in there. And they said, no, we're not doing this without the chaplain. We will find a way to get our chaplain in there, which they did. And in order to do this exercise, they had to tear down everything that they had. And one of the soldiers got a cord wrapped around his finger, and it ripped the end of his finger off. Well, we put out the word to pray for him, because the first thing they said is, well, we couldn't find the figure in time, and they couldn't get the medevac helicopter in there in time. There's no way he was ever going to get this finger working and back. And we said no, and they found the finger, and we got him medevaced and everything. Then they couldn't find the neurosurgeon. We said no. He came back within a day and a half. The finger was back on, full movement, everything, and he said maybe he might lose the little fingernail. And at the very last day, because we have classified documents that are top secret or whatever, you have to have a military police person guard them with live rounds in their weapon, and this young private lost control of his M16 rifle. It crashed to the ground. The bullet went through all 200 people, shoulder to shoulder in the tent. And the joke in the last safety briefing was that the only fatality in the entire 8 weeks was the printer that it took out on the other side of the room. So it was just so wonderful to see how these people of all different Christian backgrounds, of different faith traditions, came together and prayed for the safety of that. And the man who was our chief of staff became the highest ranking Army general that there was. And he said he would never do any kind of operation ever again unless they had chaplains with them. Mm-hmm. So it was really neat to see him see and recognize the power of prayer. And so I feel like, you know, that time I had at BU, the wonderful experience that I've had in studying the Bible every day of every week in Christian Science, I just feel like it was such a preparation for that military chaplaincy.
That's wonderful. So prayer can be ecumenical.
Absolutely.
That's great. That's good to know.
Absolutely.
Well, we have just a reminder that this is an interactive program, so we are responding to questions from people online as well as from people here in the room, and a lot have come in, so I'm going to jump into that, if that's okay, unless anybody has a burning question that they want to ask somebody else here on the panel. You probably do, but as chaplains, you're strong, and so you're resisting. Okay. This question comes from Erin, and she's in Ohio. And what she says and asks is, I would love to hear how Christian Science chaplains have or are being encouraged to minister to those of other faiths, particularly when the basic points of reasoning in Christian Science, that man is entirely spiritual, God's will is always good, there is only one mind, may contradict with what others hold as their core religious beliefs. So, yeah, how does one minister to people who maybe have a fundamental theological difference, but how do you find that ground where you can still be of pastoral value, of value in caring for somebody else?
Well, I thought Janet did a great job of illustrating that in her last story. Everyone has a sacred text. And what religion in many respects is trying to do, and something we talk about in our training, is that religion is involved in providing an answer of peace. And regardless of the distinctions or the differences between denominations, there is an answer of peace which can be found and which can be shared. She asks a very good question. There are distinctions. But one of the wonderful things about military chaplaincy specifically is it, to a certain extent, it's force, but it's a wonderful opportunity to exercise and to expand your conception of your own Christian practice and the arms of your Christian community, expanding that understanding and putting into practice how it is that you're going to engage and interact with those other denominations, because so often the differences and the distinctions come down to semantics. It comes down to language, and that answer of peace is one which can be felt and doesn't have to get tied up in language. And that's why those sacred texts are so useful in delivering it.
I like that, and I think thinking about our own sacred text, I actually had a question from a young airman last summer, and he asked if the chaplaincy or if the military makes you do things as a chaplain that go against your beliefs. And I think in a similar way, he's wondering, how do you minister to people who don't believe what you believe? You know, how do you act? And in that moment, what came to me was ultimately, what is required of me beyond loving God and loving my neighbor, right? And when you look at the story of the Samaritan, what Jesus says, you know, who is your neighbor? It might be for the Jewish person who was at the time supposed to consider a Samaritan ritually unclean, and not even talk to that person, that's your neighbor, right? And so I think despite the differences, you know, everyone is part of this human family, and loving them isn't too hard to do. Yeah.
That's great. Another interesting question has come in, and it really seems to be about how chaplains can care for one another when they're in the field, it seems. This comes from Jennifer in Ottawa, and she identifies herself as a Foreign Service officer. And she says it's crucially important to have a support network when you're out in the field. And she's just wondering what kind of support network exists for chaplains. Is there any kind of provision for that for Christian Science chaplains in the field? And are there opportunities to get together and share and support one another?
I think my experience is there is kind of a technical chain. So you have a brigade supervisor who provides kind of ministry, and then you have kind of the informal means, like through the program. We get to know the other chaplain training candidates very well, so there's always a chance to inspire and encourage. And then Janet and her role as an endorsing agent is just fantastic. And she brings a lot of that lived experience, and so it just means a great deal that she can be there and kind of understand what you're going through. So that's meant a lot to me. And I know the military as a whole is really looking into that and trying to make sure that chaplains are partnered or mentored through people who aren't in their direct line chain of command, and so that there are people that they can reach out to, because there are chaplains that fall and they realize they need that support. So that's just been my experience.
So this is an interesting question. This comes from Judy, and she's wondering if Christian Science military chaplains perform weddings. And do you take part in religious rituals such as baptisms, christenings, and communion?
I just did my first communion service this past weekend, so yes.
Okay.
As far as weddings, I haven't done anything like that.
It's interesting because in Christian Science, we like to be very meticulous about honoring the separation between church and state. And so Christian Science chaplains individually decide when they go into the military how would they honor that and do that to the best of their knowledge of how they understand that idea. And so it is a little different from Christian Science chaplain to Christian Science chaplain. Some say, I just won't do those that particular ritual. what I did when I was in was that I completely honored the idea that a Christian Science chaplain would have no part of signing the person's license or being the person who officiated at a wedding. And so, and one of the things you wrestle with in the military is if you have all these people in your unit that want to get weddings, then you have to have somebody else do your work. And so what I would do is I would talk to the individuals and explain the difference between church and state for us. And I'd say, are you comfortable that, because they have to go get the license from the whoever's the authority in that state, however it's handled in that state. So it's state of California. It's different in different states. And so when they go to get the license, you can get the state part of it done right there. You can be officially married by the time you get the license if you pay that person to have you declared officially married. And then what the church has always done is they feel that that's not enough. The church has always felt it's a very sacred institution and that they want to honor also what the sacred text talks about. And so if the person has that taken care of, then that's taken care of before. And so you do what's called the celebration of that union. And you do some people would refer to it as the blessing of the marriage. And so that part that the church does is always been separate in the United States. It's the only nation in the world that even allows a minister to do that legal part. Any other nation, you can't even, there isn't anybody can do it other than the state. So what I do, I would sometimes have that person get it done before,
Or there's always, so many times there's somebody in the family, maybe it's the dad or the mom, that wants to do that part of the ceremony. And so I would maybe start out by doing the celebration of the union, the blessing of the marriage, or whatever terms were most meaningful to those individuals, and we would do that whole part. And then I would step aside, and that person, it might be the dad, it might be the mom, it might be the best man, but somebody was always excited that they got to come up and do what was, act as the official of the state. And so in almost any state in the United States, you can get a document that allows you to do that one wedding. And so I would explain, because of the separation of church and state, now the best man or whomever was going to get up and act as the agent of the state, and they would then do the official declaration and explain that, you know, they'd sign the, however they wanted to speak to it. But that way you separate the two very clearly. So it was more based on what the family or what the couple that were being married were comfortable with. And so you did it, you wanted to meet their needs in essence. But you also wanted to be legal, and you wanted it to be meaningful spiritually to the individuals who were partaking of it.
So the questioner asked about rituals such as baptism and communion, et cetera, but I'm interested, Sarah, as a Christian Scientist, what it was like to do some preaching. For those of you who may not be aware, in Christian Science, we don't have what is typically thought of as a preaching tradition. For us in our services, we read selections from the Bible and from Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures by Mary Baker Eddy. So the image of a person in the pulpit speaking words of their own is something that isn't typical for Christian Scientists. So just very curious how that has developed for you and how you found being a preacher woman.
Personally, I really enjoy it. I really love preaching. And I think a big part of it for me is the preparation going into it. So when I'm able, I will spend as much time beforehand as possible reading over the Bible, looking at different translations, looking at definitions, thinking about it, praying about it. And when I'm preaching, I'm drawing off the inspiration that comes to me during that time. I love it. I'm still getting to know what my voice is in the pulpit and what I'm developing that because I am very new at it. But it is, for me, it's a lot of fun, and there are just these amazing new ways of seeing Bible stories and passages in things that I'd never thought before that come out during that time. And so I love preaching.
Yeah. You know, in Christian Science, we have what we call weekly Bible lesson sermons on different topics. This week it happens to be on reality. And I'm just curious, in your daily study as Christian Scientist, in preaching, for example, do you bring what you're studying in your Christian Science practice into what you're preaching about?
Absolutely. That's a really good point. Yes. One of the things that we did in one of our studying sessions with Janet is we brought sermons that we had written, and very lovingly Janet pointed out, you know, this is a real Christian Science term, like maybe you don't want to use that term, right? And or maybe watch out here for your language, because it's a little more esoteric, or it's a little more, you know, just may not be understood as widely as you think. And so And so we definitely bring our study and practice into it. Actually, one of my sermons, my first sermon that I gave for a class here, my intro to preaching class, included a testimony, which is, you know, a very big tradition in Christian Science is our testimonies of healing. And it was really wonderful to be able to include that, and I know that people really connected with that part of the sermon. And in fact, afterward, my preaching professor recommended a book to me called Preaching as Testimony, which is a wonderful book. And so it's amazing how much you really do bring from your own tradition into these.
This one is interesting. They ask, is there an emphasis in chaplain training on the liberal arts? How do the liberal arts contribute to the role of a chaplain?
I think you definitely, you learn how to express yourself. I think Brian talked about communication, and there's so much in terms of hearing and listening to what others are saying and then being able to share it, that's something coming from an engineering background that I picked up on, definitely.
I think as well, piggybacking on some of what Sarah said, preaching is not a traditional course of study. You know, sometimes they call it homiletics, but it's a different way of communication. It's not just teaching. It's something else entirely. And I think liberal arts, as far as the integration, as far as the varied study, really helps practice how it is you're going to take life experience, you're going to take anecdotes, you're going to take sacred texts, and merge these into a cohesive, communicating message. And to the extent that liberal arts is involved in that, I think it's core to what we do here at Boston University.
This question comes from a chaplain, retired from the United States Air Force. And he graduated from here in 1979 as an Air Force and became an Air Force chaplain. And he says that at that point, a number of denominations described the military chaplain as your pastor in uniform. Even though many service members were not active in the religion of their youth, many had an understanding of what a pastor was. And this person says that today an increased number have not had any history with the religious community. How are chaplains today being better prepared to reach their diverse audiences? Given that chaplains tend to come from their own religious cultures, how are they making the distinctions in language and purpose between praying in a voluntarily attended faith group worship and praying in a mandatory military formation? With many contemporary chaplains having narrow experience in their theological training and sense of mission, is there a danger that commanders will determine chaplains as less relevant to command concerns and less effectual in helping people refer to them by the commander, as well as less useful and unifying in the witness they make at mandatory unit events? So I guess that's really a question about chaplaincy in contemporary culture. Any thoughts, Mary Elizabeth, on that? How that's addressed at the BU School of Theology, that perhaps the religious background, just generally speaking, in the culture isn't as solid, as strong, as much of a frame of reference as it once was, and how does one speak to that in terms of still bringing care to others?
It's actually a very good question. There's certain capacities that are important for chaplains. I think they all go right back to what Brian said earlier when you were talking about a heart for love. You were quoting Janet, but I think that's the secret. Mm-hmm. But part of cultivating your own heart for love is diving deeply into your own traditions and listening deeply to the traditions of others, mm-hmm. and discerning the meanings that are prevalent in this culture and that culture. That circles back to the liberal arts. So studying texts, especially the sacred text, but also the text that are found in literature and film, trying to discern how people are making meaning in the larger culture. Mm-hmm. Developing that capacity allows you then to discern more adequately when you're deployed to this place or that place, what's going on in that culture. That capacity also allows you to draw deeply from your own tradition and to listen carefully to others. Mm-hmm. And that capacity is transferable. Once you begin to develop it, you can continue to develop it. Mm-hmm. Janet's story, I think, epitomizes it. Right. She was drawing deeply from her own tradition. She was inviting the traditions of others to be shared. And she was discerning what was going on in that place, the mm-hmm. kind of fear and kind of tension that was in that place. Those are very important capacities to nourish.
The National Conference on Ministry to the Armed Forces is all the persons like me and endorser who have chaplains in the military, and that this is a question that they have wrestled with for probably 20, 25 years. And one time I was asked to address it when I was the executive director of the Armed Forces Chaplains Board, because the generals didn't want to address it. And so I said, well, if you want to look at the issue, you do have to look at the actual term. And so the term is there such a thing as public prayer? And so how you define those two words would be how you respond to that situation. If you think it's a private prayer that you say in your own tradition, but it's just said in a public place, then that's different than the person who is saying, can you truly play or pray for the public? And the atheists have been a big voice in this recently because they say they don't want it. So it was interesting because Mrs. Setti wrestled with this idea. How personal is prayer? Could there truly be something that could be public prayer? And the example I'll give is one of our commanders in Europe asked his chaplain to pray for his change of command ceremony, and he asked him to bless all of his soldiers at the end of it. And the man gave a Christian blessing. Now, they had people who were Muslims, they had people who were Buddhists, they had atheists, they had everybody under the sun in this unit. And the commander was livid about the way the young man did it. And he told him, he said, I will never, ever have somebody do a public prayer again in any ceremony that I have, because some of my soldiers left feeling blessed and others didn't. And so I shared that with the endorsers. And I said, this truly is, you know, how are you making the people feel who are at that place where you're attempting to give? And I'm not underestimating how difficult it is to give a public prayer. It's truly something people wrestle with. Now, if you want to flip this to another dimension, when I was at the Pentagon as the executive director of the Armed Forces Chaplains Board, a Bosnian contingency came and they declined every briefing that the are normally given to people who come like that. And they said, no, we just want to talk to your chaplain. So they bring him to me. And that the question that they asked me that is, and you could tell exactly in this Bosnian contingency, you could tell who the Muslim was, you could tell who the Croat was, you could tell who the Serb was, you could tell who was the Orthodox priest. I mean, they had everything in there. And the guy who was heading it up looked at me and he said, we want to know how Americans can have so many different faith groups and backgrounds and everything and not kill each other. Now, that's and you're thinking, well, you know, that's what's the meaning of life in 25 words or less, you know? And so I said to him, I said, well, in America, and so I think the thing that it always goes back to me for is that we really do believe in the First Amendment and the freedom of religion. And I said, there isn't anything that an American considers more sacred and more private than a person being able to pray the way that they pray. And so we would do anything to protect that right. And I said, so most chaplains, they would make sure if there was anyone in their unit that wanted to pray in a specific way, if they had certain sacred days that they couldn't work or something, I mean, that chaplain is always monitoring for that commander, how are we going to respond to the needs of the various folks in our unit, because there's different faith groups, there's different denominations and things like that. And so the military is one of the few places that tries to be as responsive to the diversity of those needs as any place that I've ever been. And so it's out of a deep, deep sense of respect that a person would have the right to pray in the manner in which it's meaningful to them.
Well, it's really been great to spend some time with all of you, and it's made me think about going a little bit more deeply into my own practice and into my own thoughts about how to embrace all of humanity. And this is a great opportunity that you all have in the armed forces. And just so you know, we have the armed forces all equally represented here. Well, not equally, but we have them all represented. Brian is going into the Navy. Sarah is going to be Air Force, and these are Army. Now, are there Marine chaplains or specifically? So
unicorns. they are there, but the only way you can become a Marine chaplain, so far as I know, is if you spent time in the Marines as a rifleman. And then you leave for a time, go to seminary, and then come back. But they are extremely rare. Most of the Marines get Navy chaplains.
Well, one thing that I'm curious about is in dealing with the whole subject of people who are being trained as warriors, being trained to defend the country and to, if necessary, go into battle, and just operating in that sphere, how has it influenced how you think about peace and how you cherish peace? I'm just curious, any thoughts that you have, all of you, on how this work has deepened your understanding of peace?
I could share, because I had been in the Peace Corps and I was attending peace and I considered myself a pacifist. And so, you know, there was this struggle, especially my first couple years, and I had an experience about halfway through. We had had a big church conference here. It was a Church Alive. And the focus was really on living love in church. And it just really moved me. And right after that, I went to visit a relative. And when I arrived, I was going to be there 2 days, and my relative was, the situation was very irritable. The TV was on, it was really loud. Every time we tied a trough, it just didn't work. And about lunchtime, I'd been praying with the Lord's Prayer all day. And then at lunchtime, I kind of took off to get us lunch, and I was bringing it back, and I was praying about, is it good for me to stay here or to leave? You know, is this really where I need to be? And the thought came to me, it's not so much about me or her, it's about God's love for both of us. So it just kind of expanded how I was thinking about my role there. And so that evening, we went down to her center. There was a dinner, and there was a gentleman there she warned me about that was very, very open to sharing his faith. And he let me have it right off, both barrels. He didn't like the military chaplaincy, and he didn't like that I was a Christian Scientist. And that same thought came back to me. And it was just this clear sense that it's not about his theology or mine, it's about God's love for both of us. And I just looked at him and I said, you know what? God's grace has led me to this point, and I trust where it's taking me. And I said, I want to be there when God's grace is there for those soldiers. That's all I know. And he looked at me and he said, I can deal with that. And that was the end. And so the next day, things improved greatly with my relative, and it turns out that she had had a rash on her back that she described as making her feel inhuman. And so as she and her friend were talking later on the day, things improved greatly. But she was telling her friend that this had changed, and they were trying to figure out why, and she looked at me and she said, you healed me, didn't you? And of course, you know, I corrected that, and I said, if anything, it was God's love that was present. But it really taught me that I didn't need to kind of divide myself and say I'm a pacifist or I'm a military chaplain. You know, God's love is big enough and with everyone that I can trust, if this is where I am, that I'll be serving his purpose, and that, of course, is peace. So that was kind of my experience of kind of leaving that I have to be this or I have to be that and just serving.
Do you mind if I weigh in on this one?
Frequently,
I've pointed out to people who have been, wrestling with that whole idea. And I said, well, first of all, I'd like to point out that it's the Department of Defense, not aggression. And that it's interesting how many times our mission statements in the military, and especially in that Balkan area, were it was either peacemaking or peacekeeping missions. And so the very mission statement was, and in one of them was to stop the killing. And it was interesting how beautifully you saw that happen and how grateful the people in the Balkans were when they could finally have a place where they could go hold a market and somebody didn't hurt somebody else. Or it was just amazing to see the difference. And from the time we went in and had those missions in Bosnia and Kosovo and that area, it would be hard to describe the carnage you saw when you came in there. And to see the difference when we left and how lovingly people who were not in a place to feel loving towards each other when we left were doing things quite harmoniously. And we've not seen an incident in that area since we've been down there. And that area had been, they often joked about how for thousands of years somebody had been at war in that region, and that's not been the case. So I think, again, when that Bosnian contingency said, how can you live together and not kill each other, that's a very profound thing. And it's that God's love, knowing, I think you hit it on the nail, Matt, when you said that, feeling that sense of love. And to see one of our soldiers was trying to help set up one of those markets. And this is just a young private, not a chaplain, a young private. A guy came up who wanted to start a row. And he took a plank, and it had a nail in it, and he slammed it into the kid's head, and it was bleeding. And the young private took the thing out of his face and put it down, wiped the blood off, and said, we're not going to do that. And he helped them set up the different places for beans or whatever they were selling. And those people who tried to rev things up were so blown away by his peacefulness and his kindness that they stopped what they were doing and started helping. And that was just one young private in a market.
Yeah, Mary Elizabeth, having the chaplaincy program here, the chaplaincy track at the BU School of Theology, how has that informed your sense of peace?
Oh, that's a very hard question, actually.
I'm not taking it back.
No, it's not. It's a very important question. One thing that strikes me is that people drawn to military chaplaincy almost always have an understanding of their own vocation as being peacemaking. Mm-hmm. That's true of the Christian Science students. It's also true of other students of other traditions. They see themselves as engaged in the kind of peacemaking that Matt and Janet have just described. Mm-hmm. And many of them take our religion and conflict transformation program as part of their studies here, because they see themselves as actively engaged in peacemaking, often in the midst of war zones. Mm-hmm. So peacemaking is not creating something where everything is already safe and well prepared. It's living in the tensions of mm-hmm. what is, and walking into the midst of tensions and being a presence that, in my faith language, that mediates the Spirit of God, that mediates the presence of God, of the God of peace in this place. And that means that even someone who is a pacifist and who abhors violence might choose military chaplaincy because of a call to walk into the tension and to be a presence that might be transformative.
That sounds like what you did. Yeah, Sarah and Brian, so what does it make you feel and think, this idea of a deepening value or understanding of peace in the context of what you're preparing to do here at the BU School of Theology?
For me, it was really important, has been important, to have the humility to not prejudge where the love of Christ, the love of whatever divine source people are observing and interested in communing with, that you don't prejudge where that goes and where it can be shared and where it can be felt. And so in military chaplaincy, the wonderful opportunity is that, as Janet pointed out several times, there is the chance in religious traditions to sometimes they hold up in the church. But the wonder, the harmony and the peace that's possible when you go on those 15-mile road marches, when you find those incidental ways of connecting with others, that incidental ministry is a lot of what distinguishes between kind of relevance and irrelevance. There was a question earlier, you know, as far as how do they stay relevant. I think it is opening up that opportunity and that understanding of peace. And for me, it's by not prejudging where it goes, who can feel it, how it can be expressed. And
It's so hard for me not to just say what they said. because what has been said is so true and wonderful. But something that just came to me was that in several conversations I've had with service members and also with members who are part of our ROTC here at BU, what I've heard from them about going into the military is that they were answering a call in some way, not always using that language, but these young people talk about feeling a call to this, feeling a call to something more, something higher. And I think that that's very different from the way many popular conceptions about the military are and that are out there. It's different from the way that they are portrayed. And it was really amazing to me to meet all these young people who want to work for peace, who appreciate it and love it. And like Dean Moore said, they're going to walk into the tension to be a presence there. And I really admire them for that.
Well, I want to thank you all and thank our on-site audience as well as our online audience for participating in our webcast today. So thank you so much, Matt, Janet, Mary Elizabeth, Sarah, Brian. You know, it's interesting for me in my own practice of Christian Science, I read this one quotation of Mary Baker Eddy almost every day. And in it she asks for one to pray for the prosperity of our country and for her victory under arms, that justice, mercy, and peace continue to characterize her government, and that they shall rule all nations, meaning that justice, mercy, and peace shall rule all nations. So I think you're all very much a part of that effort to support our country, but also to support that higher aim of justice, mercy, and peace ruling over all nations. So thank you so much for doing what you're doing, and thanks to the BU School of Theology for what it's doing in preparing people to go into this field. And thank you again.